Hey, I'm Dave. Welcome to my shop. I'm Dave Plummer, a retired operating systems engineer from Microsoft, going back to the MS-DOS and Windows 95 days, and I'm here to answer the important big historical questions like, why are blue screens blue? After all, someone had to decide, but who and why? I tracked down the actual developer responsible in the first place, and the reasons might surprise you. I know I wouldn't have guessed, and you won't have either. But did you also know that blue screens are sometimes green? And would you like to impress your friends by having a red blue screen? I'll show you how. Then I'll take you on a tour of blue screens going all the way back to Windows 1.0 and show you what they used to look like. All that, plus what causes them in the first place and how to fix them on Windows 10, coming right up on Dave's Garage. Before we worry about why blue screens are blue and when they're not, we need to talk about why they exist at all. Then we'll look at some infamous blue screens, like the one where Windows 98 blew up live on stage for Bill Gates, and I'll relate a few blue screen stories from the trenches. And so first, we should at least talk about what blue screens are, why they happen, whether they're avoidable in the first place, and how to fix them if not. As you likely know, a blue screen is the end of the line. It's a screen displayed to you when the system instantly locks up and shuts down. If you're not up to speed on the issues surrounding them, it might seem rather drastic of the operating system to completely shut down and lock things up the moment the slightest thing goes wrong inside the kernel, but that's precisely what it does. But what's the alternative and what would the implications be? And by the way, I never once heard the term blue screen of death at Microsoft, only on the internet afterwards. We called it primarily just a blue screen, or more frequently, a bug check. Well, that's the name of the API down in the kernel that allows you to raise a blue screen in the unfortunate event that one is needed, and so that was the internal name we generally used. Like all the great words, it can be both a verb and a noun. When it comes to software demos, a blue screen is synonymous with serious failure. The last thing you want is for your demo to end in a blue screen at a big conference or up on stage. Let's have a look at a famous blue screen. Back in 1998, a nervous-looking Chris Capicella was ready to plug a scanner into a Windows 98 desktop and demonstrate how plug-and-play would automatically detect it.
Let's plug it in. It's going to say, hey, I see you plugged in a new device, and it's going to load in the appropriate drivers. You'll notice that this scanner build... Whoa. Moving right along.
That must be why we're not shipping Windows 98 yet.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
They cut away quickly, but you'll notice Bill's first reaction is actually to smile. He seems more chagrined than angry, at least on the stage. His quip about not being quite ready to ship was prescient and kind of funny. It does happen. I've heard a ton of rumors that the poor guy in the demo was summarily fired and so on, but it's not true. Chris went on to do pretty well at Microsoft and is currently the CMO, or Chief Marketing Officer, of the entire worldwide consumer business. So clearly, even blue screening the system during a Windows Live demo with Bill on stage turns out not to be a career-limiting move. I wasn't there, but I'm told another blue screen happened when Bill was demoing Forza, the racing video game. Reportedly, it was still very early in the product development cycle, and not everyone was excited about the prospect of using the early code in an important demo, but the program manager, or PM, was insistent. The PM tested the demo 9 ways from Sunday, and it worked flawlessly each and every time. A few hours before the demo, they tested it a couple more times to confirm it was still ready to go, which it was, and soon enough, the time came for the actual demo. Bill grabbed one controller and the PM grabbed the other, but rather than a driving battle royale, the machine bluescreened. But how? Why, after testing it so successfully so many times, did it crash on stage? A little investigation turned up a simple explanation. The early code had memory leaks, and so it would work the first time through, but if the machine had been up for too long or they had tested the demo too many times, the memory leaks would have accumulated and eventually a blue screen would result. That's one thing in a very early beta, perhaps, but what causes a blue screen when you're using a shipping version of the operating system? Well, as I said, literally it happens when code in the kernel decides it's appropriate or unavoidable for whatever reason to call the KE bug check API. The KE is for kernel. Calling that API is a little like pulling the fire alarm in a theater. It's a serious thing, the operating system's way of tearing the tent down around itself. But what kinds of things go wrong that the operating system is so excited about that it's willing to throw away your work in progress and lock up irretrievably? Well, rest assured, it's only done truly as a last resort when there are no other safe options. In the simplest case, let's say the kernel commits an access violation, by which I mean it reads or writes memory that it doesn't own. As soon as the attempt to write to memory outside the kernel's control is made, a part of the processor known as the Memory Management Unit, or MMU, detects it and raises an exception. Windows catches that exception and ultimately bug checks the system, putting up the dreaded blue screen. Note importantly, though, that this all happens before the memory is actually corrupted. In this case, any such illegal writes are not only detected, but they are also prevented from happening at all. Philosophically, that's important because it means that the system might come to a premature halt, but it's never in a corrupted state. It's alive, or it's dead, but it's never a zombie. It's unfortunate that you can lose work in progress, but it's better than corrupting already saved work in the form of data loss. Data loss is always the much greater sin. You can contrast that with the 16-bit days. Back in Windows 3.1, for example, and even continuing on through Win 95, the fatal exception screen was also blue, but it allowed you to continue at your option. The system would tell you that it was borked, but if you wanted to keep on a driving old Bessie on five cylinders, that was up to you. You at least had a shot at trying to save your work before the machine burst into flames or did whatever it was going to ultimately do. With NT, it's not so simple. It's supposed to be robust and secure and trustworthy, meaning borked was not really in our vocabulary. And it really has to be that way if you stop and think about it. What if the system is running inside of an ATM and the memory that's being illegally cleared is also the flag that keeps track of how many $100 bills have been dispensed? Or perhaps it's some important function in a healthcare monitor. Now, I don't even know if the Windows license allows for use in situations where life and limb are at risk, but if you want to know what the reality is, consider this. When the Fukushima power plant melted down not that long ago, 48,000 of their PCs were running Windows. But not just any Windows. They were still running XP, even though it was well past end-of-life support. The reality is, or at least it used to be, that by the time Windows ships, the kernel itself is pretty rock solid. I've seen a lot of blue screens out in the world, and even debugged my fair share out there, and it's never wound up being caused by an actual kernel bug in a shipping version of Windows. Like compiler bugs, they do exist, of course, but in my real-world experience, it's always turned out to be something else, and it's most often a bad device driver. And that's a weakness in most all traditional operating systems. The device drivers run at the same privilege level as the kernel. A device driver acts as though it were part of the kernel itself, and its bugs are the same as kernel bugs. A simple access violation in a graphics driver will immediately blue screen the system. And it has to, because it has access to the same memory that the kernel does, which is to say, every byte of the entire system. A poorly written or poorly tested driver can truly be the Achilles heel of an otherwise solid system. One fix Microsoft has come up with is to move progressively more and more drivers out of kernel space and into plain old user space. It's more work for the driver authors, but a big win for stability. Printers, for example. It was a painful transition at first, but a worthwhile one. Now, if your printer driver crashes, it does so in user space, and worst case, brings down the process that was doing the printing. Sound drivers have similarly been moved. Changes like that have gone a long way towards making software blue screens far less common than they used to be. Ironically, one step backwards in stability came, at least in theory, when the NT video subsystem was moved into the kernel for performance reasons. In the very early days, even the video drivers were in user mode. If your thread wanted to make a call to your graphics card, a kernel thread would copy all the data over to the kernel side and then do the system call for you. It meant the video driver could crash on its side without ever bringing the system down, but at a performance penalty, so they moved those drivers into the kernel around the XP timeframe. One big improvement came with Windows 2000 and the introduction of what is known as the driver verifier, a special version of the kernel that stresses and abuses drivers in strange ways in an attempt to get them to fail. These two changes, the driver verifier and the user mode driver model, likely went further than anything else in reducing the number of Windows blue screens. Let's take a quick look at blue screens over time. We'll start with the Windows 1.0 screen, which, as you can see, does little more than simply show you what appears to be a memory buffer. Perhaps if you're lucky, you'd be able to see whatever corruption was written to it, but it's clearly not much use other than to confirm that the system has indeed crashed. That screen was used on Windows 2 as well. It was finally replaced with something a little more informative by Windows 3.1. And it is in Windows 3.1 that we find the first evidence of a proper crash screen, more correctly known as the Control-Alt-Delete screen. With white text on a blue background and a text message explaining the crash, it turns out that the Windows 95 blue screen was the creation of Raymond Chen. It further turns out that Raymond was responsible not only for the Windows 95 blue screen, but also for the Windows 3.1 blue screen. I should note that he also correctly identifies them as Control-Alt-Delete screens, but I'll let you mentally lump it in with the other blue screens for now. But what's more surprising is that Raymond does not take credit for the text that you find on the Control-Alt-Delete screen. Because as he explained, the actual author of the Control-Alt-Delete text for Windows 3.1 was none other than Steve Ballmer himself. As it turns out, Steve was visiting the operating systems division one day and saw an early prototype that was displaying that fatal information screen, but he didn't like the wording he saw. Someone suggested that if Steve thought he could do better, maybe he should try it himself, and so of course, he did. He went home and wrote it out and then emailed Raymond the text that should appear on the screen, and Raymond dutifully put it into the product almost verbatim, where it was enshrined for the ages. All I had to do then was to find the author of what is now the Windows 10 Bluescreen code and confirm that he or she had been inspired by the Windows 3.1 Control-Alt-Delete screen, and the circle would be complete. A tidy story, wrapped in a ribbon, tied in a knot with a bow, and all of that. And that is why I must now tell you the tale of how I dug through the source code comments and version control logs in order to track down the information on who actually wrote the code for the Windows NT Bluescreen. It turns out the developer's alias was JVert, short for John Vert. Searching for the Bluescreen dev, whose name means green, I ultimately located him at his new home, at the Redmond Town Center for Peaceful Living. The staff directed me to his little cabin, where I found a grizzled old man rocking in a chair, stroking his long white beard, mumbling to himself. I approached him as if he were a skittish deer, lest he got spooked, and when I got close enough, I said only three words. But why blue? He tipped his head back, and he cackled at me in a way that only someone truly mad can do, and as he raised a bony finger to point at the sky, that's when I realized I probably had the wrong John Vert, as there were several in the phone book. So I went home and sent a message on Facebook to someone who looked a lot more like I remember him. The correct John got back to me promptly and quickly dispelled two assumptions that I'd made about the Bluescreen. For years, I had assumed that Bluescreens were blue in order to make them easier to spot in the lab. By the mid-90s, we had a few large rooms that contained perhaps a few dozen PCs on shelves running stress tests each day on the latest operating system builds. You could walk into a lab and simply by glancing around easily spot where the troublemaker was. Somehow, I long assumed that this was the reason, as if I had heard that from someone authoritative, but now I didn't have to guess, I could hear it first person from the fellow who actually wrote the code to turn the screen blue in the first place. It turns out that while perhaps convenient later, John said that labs were not a factor in his original decision since the bug check screen was done long before there were any large labs running anti-stress. A second assumption I made, one that also turned out not to be true at all, was that because both Windows NT and Windows 3.1 had fatal error screens that were white on blue, that NT had simply followed a precedent that Windows 3.1 had set. John said that this was also not true. In fact, most of the early NT guys likely never used Win 3.1. I'll also point out that Windows was not the original UI for NT, the OS2 presentation manager would have been. So, for Windows NT at least, the Bluescreen is actually older than Windows NT as we know it. If NT and Windows 95 did not have a shared heritage then, that means John Vert is the father of the modern Windows 10 Bluescreen. So now we have a singular father, and finally, he could tell me why it was blue. The first contributing factor is that the lowest common denominator for the video hardware that NT could run on had a very rudimentary color text mode. The number of color choices were not infinite, and among them, white on a dark color is a pretty natural choice. But even so, why blue? Put simply, because John's dev machine was a MIPS RISC box, and the firmware on that machine was white on blue. Using the same color scheme led to a more consistent experience. And in fact, his favorite editor at the time was SlickEdit, and the default text colors for SlickEdit were also white on blue. You could boot, code, and crash all in the same color scheme, white on blue. And so that's why Bluescreens are blue, because in the old days, the MIPS firmware screen was. If you want to go back even further, I worked on the MS-DOS setup program, which, from about MS-DOS 5 on, used a light gray on blue color scheme. But I think pointing to any of those as the progenitor of the Bluescreen would be a pretty big reach. If you want to be super pedantic, Bluescreens are not even pure blue anymore, as in Windows 10 they've adjusted the color tone so as to technically be cerulean, which is a shade of blue ranging somewhere between azure and a darker sky blue. And now the next time your friend's gaming rig crashes, you can drop a cerulean screen reference, because now you know why blue screens are cerulean. Hang in there for a minute, and I'll tell you how to impress your friends and frighten your enemies by making your blue screens bright red. If you enjoyed this particular story, but you're not yet subscribed to my channel, I'd be honored if you took a moment to do so right now. That'll also let me know that I'm going the right direction with this episode, and I'll make more like it, and if you turn on the bell icon, you'd even get notified of them when I do. It's a win-win. And as always, remember, I'm not selling anything and I don't have any Patreons. I'm just in this for the subs and likes, so if you did enjoy the episode, please be sure to leave me one of each before going. YouTube apparently really does care if you like the video or not. They call it engagement. Speaking of which, I'm trying to grow the channel, so if there's somewhere that you can share this episode, like an appropriate place to list it on Reddit or a forum or a BBS or that sort of thing, please do so. It's kind of a niche interest, but odds are that if you're interested, then someone else you know who's like you will be interested too, so send them a link. And don't forget to head on over to Dave's Garage at the end of the month for a live stream on Sunday the 28th of February at 10 a.m. Pacific, 1 p.m. Eastern. All questions will be answered, all inquiries addressed, and you can help me plan for future episodes. The more the merrier, so bring a friend. Our first ever live stream that we barely announced had 1,000 folks show up, and it was a lot of fun, so please do stop on by on the 28th. Now on the topic of how to make your blue screens red, I was about to tell you how to hack the 386 enhanced section of the system.ini file, which is the manual way. But in talking to Raymond, as is par for the course, he pointed out an easier way that I didn't know about. And that's to download an app called Not My Fault by Mark Rasunovich, one of the guys from SysInternals. As long as you run it as administrator, it will temporarily install a driver that will intentionally blue screen the system with a bug check color of your choice. You can pick red or even a lovely shade of fuchsia if you like, pretty much any color from the VGA color palette. I'll link to the app's homepage in the video description. I can't promise it'll work on the latest Windows 10 without some registry hacks to get you back to a traditional blue screen display without the smiley and all that, but it works well on anything that actually shows the stop message. Thanks for joining me here in the shop. In the meantime and in between time, I hope to see you next time here in Dave's Garage. This little chair will be waiting for one of you. And a rocking chair for another who likes to rock. And a big armchair for two to curl up in. All next time on Dave's Garage.